The following is only a slice of the story of the Wellsburg, Bethany, and Washington Railway. From 1908 to 1926, this trolley line ran approximately 7.1 miles from Wellsburg, West Virginia to Bethany, West Virginia, which is about 60 miles south of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. There really is not enough time to talk about the many interesting aspects of this little rail line. This trolley would seem to be very unremarkable if it were not for the level of determination and creativity used to fight the many difficulties associated with the line. Some were economic problems similar to those being experienced currently. However, it would be an oversimplification not to mention that there were other challenges that were unique to this time and place, which adds to the magical aspects of this line. This piece of wb&w history is not about how this railway had been developed while there were numerous unsuccessful attempts in prior decades. Also, it is not how the construction of the rails seemed to defy gravity or at least standard engineering principles. It was nicknamed the goat because of the way it traveled through the mountains. You can get that feeling today by traveling by car on West Virginia Route 67 from Wellsburg to Bethany. Nor is it about how it saved Bethany College and its surrounding community from extinction, or was to be the great hope of another community, Wellsburg, to connect with new markets, or how one of its founders, Thomas Ellsworth Cramblett, who was a pastor and president of Bethany College, knew nothing about trolleys except that he came from Pittsburgh and rode them to his church occasionally. Another founder, Harmon Greathouse Leisure, was a Wellsburg businessman who had been involved in mining, canning, farming, glassware, building, and real estate. He only had been remotely involved with the railway. The story will not describe the tragic way which they both died. The history of the wb&w is more than that of a trolley line. It is a description of a couple of communities and their goals, dreams, successes, failures, and anything else that drives people. The following story will only touch on a small portion of this railway. That piece is the unusual, funny, and sometimes tragic occurrences involved with the trolley. It includes painful as well as ridiculous events. Not too different from life in general. During cold, icy mornings, the rails were exceptionally dangerous. The ice that formed on the rails drastically decreased the traction. Riding down Buchanan's Hill under such conditions was like sliding down an icy slope, one engineer mentioned. It was on this hill where one of the line's only serious derailments occurred. On May 7, 1917, the double truck number 5 car was making its second run from Bethany. The 8 a.m. trolley was proceeding along the narrows, a dangerous segment of the route in itself. The conductor, John Huff, had just finished collecting the fares from the last stop. John Mac McDonald, the motorman, was preparing to descend the steep Buchanan's Hill. The air brakes were applied to slow the car down from its normal rate. Since the hill was abnormally steep for a trolley, extreme care had to be observed. The air brakes did not respond. McDonald attempted to apply the manual cable brakes. They also failed to respond, and a piece of iron snapped with a loud sound under the car and just under McDonald's seat. While McDonald was continuing his efforts to halt the trolley was gaining speed with every foot down the hill. All the passengers stood up. At that moment, they were caught between deciding to jump or ride out the uncontrolled downhill run. Ultimately, whether they braced themselves for the crash or were paralyzed by indecision, they all stayed in the car, all except one. A contractor from Bethany College, George Clymer, 67, in an attempt to flee the runaway car, was fighting his way out of the car window and struck his head on a passing object. His head injuries were so severe that he died a few minutes after being rushed by the automobile to Wellsburg. We noticed that others stayed with the flying coach, and we decided, as it was hazardous to jump, said Mr. Wilkin, a passenger. The car passed the switch at the coal mine halfway down the hill, but reached the curve in the road near the bottom of the hill opposite Mr. Bowman's house. It left the rails and was shot as from a catapult through the air. The coach came down on its side and skidded along an exposed gas pipe for a distance of nearly 100 feet. The motorman, John McDonald, proved himself a hero since he stayed at the controls to the point of impact, relentlessly attempting to engage the malfunctioning emergency brake. As the car lay on its side, among the first people to reach the wreck were John Bowman and his son Walter. John Bowman was about to leave his home when the car toppled over immediately below his gate. The news spread rapidly. Shortly, a crowd of curious onlookers appeared. One passenger observed, "The screams were terrible." The Bowman House was converted into a temporary hospital to care for the many injured. Reverend Edward Gordon, age 60, suffered internal injuries. His son, Edward Gordon Jr., approximately 20, and a student at Bethany, sustained broken ribs and other injuries to list him as having a doubtful survival. Mrs. Simon Luke, age 74, received bodily bruises and possible fatal internal injuries. Others suffered dislocated shoulders, fractured arms, broken ankles, and broken thumbs. John McDonald, motorman, was drenched with cans of milk upon impact. The cans were part of the trolley cargo. John Bowman was seen trying to revive the motorman on his lawn. He was covered with severe cuts around his face and body. Bowman later was quoted as saying, "He looked like a drowned rat." A year earlier, in 1916, the first fatality occurred. Old Mr. Waugh, as David Waugh was referred to, had a practice of walking from his mill through one of the two tunnels on the trolley route to check on his power source, the dam. Waugh's mill was located on the McKinleyville side of the second tunnel from Bethany. The dam was on Buffalo Creek, which was 30 to 40 feet from the tunnel. Mr. Waugh had checked the dam and was walking back through the tunnel. His back to the oncoming trolley. The trolley had the right-of-way. Dick Suddeth, the motorman, rang the bell as a warning before entering the tunnel. Mr. Waugh's daughter-in-law observed that it was snowing and that visibility was very poor. "My husband's father was hard of hearing and did not see the trolley coming, and the trolley driver did not see him." Entering the tunnel at about 4 or 5 miles an hour and equipped with a small electric light, the car was not prepared to make any sudden stops. The trolley stopped after going through the tunnel since several riders felt they had passed over something. Going back into the tunnel, they discovered Waugh's body. How could Richard Waugh have realized in 1833, when he completed the construction of the tunnels, that one of these would be the key element to his son's death? Although the Buchanan's Hill and Waugh accidents were the only instances involving human fatalities, they were far from the only deaths that occurred on the line. It became so frequent to see a cow, deer, horse, or some other local animal lying on the side of the tracks that the county commissioner was heard sarcastically saying he was considering requiring the company to apply for a hunter's license. Since the front of the trolley was of a thin metal, the occasional collisions added to the numerous dents on the car. It was thought that a popular means of regaining a portion of the expense of a worn-out cow or horse was to let it wander near the tracks. When the trolley inevitably struck it, the company was obliged to pay. Cows and horses were not the only obstacles that the trolley had to overcome. The wb&w was a constant victim of pranks. In an effort to derail the car, railroad spikes were placed on the tracks. Occasionally, the prank succeeded. A popular site for another joke was at Point Breeze, which was a high, sharp turn on the outer edge of Bethany. When the trolley ran over dynamite caps carefully placed on the rails, it almost gave the impression the hill was giving way. A less destructive but difficult and dangerous prank usually occurred on Main Street in Bethany. A few of the local adolescents would run behind the trolley, climb onto the roof, and disconnect the pole from the power line. As the car came to a gradual halt, the pranksters would run to escape the anger of the motorman. This did not damage the car, however, there was considerable hazard and difficulty involved climbing to the top of the moving trolley. The favorite prank of all was stealing the car at night or early morning when the local youth would push it and ride down the hill on Main Street in Bethany. On one of these occasions, panic set in amongst the conspirators. As they were riding down the hill, the trolley appeared to be rolling faster than usual. It became apparent that the trolley was not going to stop before the dead end at the intersection of Church and Main Streets in Bethany. The car might, they feared, jump the track, proceed toward the next hill, and run into Bethany Creek. Fortunately, when the trolley did jump the track, it continued for only about a half a block short of the feared next hill. The trolley stopped in front of what was known as the Zeta Tau Alpha house. The next day, the Zeta porch furniture was found sitting on top of the car. For years after this prank, the grooves that were cut into the brick by the runaway trolley could be seen until the street was paved. The wb&w trolley was also plagued by nature's mischief. Trees occasionally either would fall and block the track or break the power line. After heavy rains, especially in the later years, slippages were fairly common. There were occasions when the trolley confronted sections of the rail hanging in midair over a cliff. Typically, this occurred along the winding Bethany Pike of the route. As a quick remedy, another trolley would meet the passengers on the other side of the slippage. An additional product of the rains was an unusually rough ride. The grating beneath the track would erode, causing the rails to sink, thus producing dips along the route. Because of the condition of the route, there were occasions when passengers had to postpone their trips for days until the track could be repaired. Visualize being the motorman after a heavy rain and going down the tracks where you know there are problems with slippages. The conductor probably was up front watching as well. An average-sized trolley moving at 5 miles an hour will stop within 12 and a half feet. Traveling at 10 miles an hour, 34 feet is required. What was it like navigating the car at night after a heavy rain, knowing that a rail could be suspended in air? The range on a single headlight on the original trolleys were limited. What were the passengers thinking as they were tentatively rolling along a route that endangered their life? After a while, the trolleys were very much ingrained into the social makeup of Bethany College life. On Saturdays, students would use the trolley to go into Wellsburg. When the car was packed with students, the conductor would have to squeeze his way through the crowd to collect the fare. As he made his way down the aisle, and unpaid students would slip outside the slow-moving car before the conductor approached them. They could easily keep pace with the trolley and would re-enter in the front of the car. They would be behind the conductor and amongst the crowd from whom the conductor had already collected fares. Clothes were exchanged with paying students to further confuse the conductor. Inadvertently, a motorman once stunted the progress of the trolley's schedule. At 12 a.m., when all the lights were off in Bethany, the trolley was making its last run into the college. As the car was traveling towards the wooden trestle, the pole slipped from the power line. The trolley rolled gradually to a halt. Ray Dowden, the motorman, thought that the car was still a few feet from the trestle and still on firm ground. In an effort to put the pole back on the line, he took a step out of the car. His first and subsequent steps met only air. He required more than a year to recover from the misstep. There is much more to be told about the Wellsburg, Bethany, and Washington Railway. Trolleys are not merely machines, but products of people. When people are involved, there are always interesting stories.